September 12th, 1962. President John F. Kennedy stands at a stadium in Texas, trying to convince the public to do something extraordinary. To put a man on the moon.
There is no strife, no prejudice, no national conflict in outer space as yet,
he says.
Its hazards are hostile to us all. Its conquest deserves the best of all mankind. And its opportunity for peaceful cooperation may never come again. But why, some say, the moon? Why choose this as our goal? And they may well ask, why climb the highest mountain? Why, 35 years ago, fly the Atlantic? We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one we're willing to accept, one we're unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win.
This telling of the next chapter in human spaceflight is brought to you by the fine folks at Digital Extremes, creators of my free-to-play fave Warframe and its newest expansion, Empyrean. Check it out at the link below and complete missions successfully in-game until December 31st to earn entries for a chance to win $250,000 towards an actual spaceflight of your very own. May 18th, 1959, Cape Canaveral. These are the Mercury 7, the best of the best. All military test pilots selected via one of the most demanding regiments in history. They'd been baked under lamps, flattened in G-force chambers, kept in isolation, and made to work complex problems in a vibrating chair. A month before, they'd been presented to the public and became instant celebrities. America's first astronauts. And now, they've gathered to watch a test flight of the rocket that will take them into orbit. The force of the engine slaps their chest, and the roar arrives. The rocket rises, a bright arrow streaking into heaven. They whoop and cheer. The explosion lights up the night sky. As the detonation echoes towards the stunned men, Alan Shepard turns to his colleague, John Glenn.
Well, he says, I'm glad they got that out of the way.
This failed test was not an anomaly. In fact, it captured the challenge America faced in the early years of the space race. As it entered the 1960s, the U.S. space program was still finding its feet. After the launch of Sputnik, Eisenhower had pushed for a satellite launch to answer the Soviets, and the Navy stepped up with a massive media blitz, launching a satellite atop one of their Vanguard rockets. The Vanguard rose 4 feet before collapsing and exploding on the launch pad, its fiery demise broadcast around the world. It was clear America's rocket program needed reform, and from that reform came the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, or NASA. Because the Eisenhower administration worried about the weaponization of space, American spaceflight would not be a military endeavor, but a civilian one, dedicated to science and exploration, bringing together engineers, bureaucrats, military test pilots, and the infamous Wernher von Braun, whose Redstone series rockets were the key to American spaceflight, and they set out to reach the stars. The problem was, they couldn't seem to get there before the USSR, because Sputnik wasn't an isolated incident. A month before Alan Shepard was to be the first man in space, Yuri Gagarin took the title. And not only that, but he orbited the planet, something that wasn't even planned for Shepard's flight. And by the time Project Mercury got a person into orbit, the Soviets had put a man in orbit twice. Despite NASA's advanced equipment, rigorous training, and a budget that dwarfed their Soviet rivals, the public, though celebrating America's success, felt that the U.S. was losing the space race. But not everything is about being first. And though the Explorer satellite and Mercury programs had not beaten the Soviets, they'd yielded scientific discoveries and technical achievements that put the U.S. into a good position for its next step into the great dark. Gemini. Because America had a new president, and NASA a new champion. Kennedy's moonshot gave NASA an overarching goal. A sense of cohesiveness and national mission that brought rivals together and shook loose necessary support. And it provided a political will and funding the Soviets never had. And that such a monumental endeavor needed to succeed. The equivalent of $153 billion in today's currency, to be exact. Whoo, I could buy a lot of platinum. The most expensive technological project ever undertaken in peacetime. NASA would need to send men 240,000 miles away and have them survive in an environment more hostile than almost any found on Earth. Relying every step of the way on technologies that did not yet exist, in fields at the bleeding edge of science. NASA swelled to over 400,000 employees, and Gemini went ahead. A series of two-man missions, perfecting skills like working in a capsule, practicing orbital rendezvous, docking, and the first American spacewalk. And crews learned to live in space, just for 4 days at first, but eventually as long as 2 weeks, eating specially prepared space food and conducting exterior repairs as the blue-green globe of the world rolled past, distant storms swirling its surface. And all this in preparation for the big event, a manned landing on the moon. Kennedy, however, would not live to see Gemini's success. On November 22, 1963, an assassin gunned him down in Dallas. Only the day before, he'd given a speech that championed the impact of spaceflight on medical research. His successor, Lyndon Johnson, a long spaceflight advocate, took up the torch. He leaned on contacts in the Senate, ensuring the money came through and casting NASA as a slain president's legacy. All launches would now happen at the renamed Kennedy Space Center. Apollo would fly. January 27, 1967. Cape Kennedy, Launch Complex 34. The crew of the Apollo 1 sits nearly shoulder to shoulder. Countdown. 3, 2, 1. Everything's looking good, but there's a strange smell. And the radio's cutting out again? How are they supposed to get to the moon if they can't even talk between two buildings?
You hear us?
On the other end, engineers listening to the garbled transmission suddenly hear a shout.
Hey! Fire!
The crew biometrics spike, 3 seconds since the report of fire. 4. They can see the crew on the monitor struggling to reach the door. Engineers rush toward the launch pad. 5 seconds.
We're burning up!
A scream is the last thing heard from Apollo 1. All 3 crew members perish in a flash fire, fed by the pure oxygen environment of the capsule. One of the dead, Gus Grissom, is one of the original Mercury 7. 6 years before, he'd narrowly escaped drowning when the hatch of his Mercury capsule blew early, sinking his craft in the Pacific Ocean. And during Gemini, his helmet's faceplate cracked during a violent re-entry. These occurrences had made him think about death. If we die, he told a newspaper after the Gemini mission, we want people to accept it. We are in a risky business, and we hope if anything happens to us, it'll not delay the program. The conquest of space is worth the risk of life. Still, winning the moon race was not worth losing more crews. NASA delayed 20 months as it made safety adjustments. Then they moved up the schedule. On Christmas Eve, 1968, the crew of Apollo 8 broadcast images of the Earth rising above the moon, reading lines from the Book of Genesis. 3 days earlier, they had achieved orbit around the Earth, then burned the third stage engines of their Saturn V until they reached speeds of 35,000 feet per second, enough to escape the Earth's gravity and enter the pull of Luna. But they would not land, nor would the ones that came after them. No, this was all a cautious rehearsal. It was for others to take that first step. July 20th, 1969, 2017 hours, UTC. The pilot looks out of the lander and sees gray boulder fields. They're burning too much fuel. He steers the lander towards a clear patch. Wait, no, it's a crater. He readjusts. Low fuel warning. He can't really see due to all the dust kicking up. An indicator. They've touched the surface. He lets it down slow. 25 seconds more, and they would have had to return to the command module in orbit. And 6 hours later, he opens the hatch and descends the ladder. The image of the Earth rising over the moon is still with him, and human turmoil seems very small and far away. So much has changed in the decade since JFK challenged them to go to the moon. Kennedy is dead. Khrushchev is out of power. President Johnson has given way to Nixon. Eisenhower, who created NASA, died of heart failure only 4 months ago. People are in the streets fighting for civil rights, and America is fighting a costly war in Vietnam. Which is partially why Neil Armstrong will be stepping out first. He had resigned his commission on leaving the Navy, and was America's only civilian astronaut. That's the message they want to send. This is an American mission, but not a military one. In his personal bag, he carries a piece of wood from the Wright Flyer and an Apollo 1 patch, which he plans to leave on the surface. And before stepping off the ladder, he uncovers the plaque. The one thing that, more than the flag, more than the call from the president, will memorialize what they do here today. It reads, actually, Lotus, would you please do the honors?
Here men from the planet Earth first set foot on the moon, July 1969 AD. We came in peace for all mankind.
Then, he takes one small step.
Such an inspiring moment. I've always enjoyed reading that plaque since I first came across it ages ago.
Clem!
Wait, she did what to the moon?
Clem, spoilers. What are you even doing here?
Oh, I invited Clem over to join my Empyrean squad. We're gonna jump back into my railjack with the rest of the EC crew for some spacefaring action. But also, we're gonna help out other Tenno in need via the new squad link system, where actions we can take planetside will affect other battles in the stars in real time. Picture the Battle of Endor that you're in control of, just without all those pesky Ewoks and their yub-yub nonsense language.
Clem!
Elegantly put, Clem. Thanks for the reminder. Also, by opting in at the link below, you'll be entered into the Become a Real Space Ninja sweepstakes, where you can complete successful missions in-game until December 31st to earn entries for a chance to win $250,000 towards an actual trip to actual space.
So, what are you waiting for, Tenno?
I mean, we're already in space. I could log in, I guess.
No, I meant the actual Tenno. Animated internet hosts and Clems are not eligible.
That's some cold shade, Lotus.
Clem!